All right, so what we do on Wednesday night is Jay and I have a conversation. Jen Dog, please feel free to pitch in if you have anything you want to say.
Jump in and, with us.
Today we're talking about how can ethical culture, what does it need to be for the next generation? So you want to start off with your Odoo?
Yeah, I just want to make sure I can be heard because I feel so like
I know.
Muffled.
I can hear you.
Okay, as long as everybody else can hear me. Beautiful. You know, it's interesting to talk about, you know, bringing actually a hip hop artist in this time and then have the intersections of hip hop and ethical humanism with, right?
I'm liking it.
Future.
I'm
it's a blend, right? It's a blend. And I mean, I would be remiss if I didn't share, you know, something that was, you know, has been passed, right? From this idea of just the crossroads and how we think about when we're making decisions. Crossroads are really choices and decisions. Mm-hmm. And Liz pointed out to us some decisions. And I just want to share this Odu, which is, an Odu in Yoruba is another word for proverb. And so in this Odu, there are particular spirit guides. These spirit guides, they are actually sent to Earth to make everything do what it do, right? And so all of a sudden, there's seven of these spiritual guides. They are making water. They are making thunder. It is raining. It is doing. And it's this beautiful pantheon. But there's one specific one. She actually is the spirit guide of beauty and love.
Wow.
And what she does is she is walking around and she's looking. And the other spirit guides kind of judge her and criticize her and be like, you're not doing anything. But of course, I mean, what she's walking around, she has a mirror in her, you know, she has a hand in her, and she's a mirror in her hand, and she's looking at herself, and you're not doing anything. What good are you? And so she's insulted. So what she does is she leaves all the other spirit guides there, and she goes to the top of the moon, and she sits on the moon to powder her face because she's so insulted.
I get it.
She's done. And the funny thing is that they continue to work. They don't even think about love and beauty anymore. They leave her to be. And they continue. And as they continue, they realize things are falling apart. The ground is too soft to even have foundation. The water is drying up. The insects are not even actually cross-pollinating. Nothing is happening. The storms seem to get out of control.
Mm-hmm.
And all of these things are just happening. Chaos. And so they call their Supreme. And they're like, why did you send us here if nothing is taking hold? And the Supreme looks down and they kind of look down and they see and they're like, well, all of you are except for one. Where is love and beauty? And love and beauty is still sitting on the moon, powdering their face, looking in the mirror, done and upset, busted and disgusted, highly upset about this situation. And she decides to come down. And the Supreme says, what happened? Why aren't you here? And she explains that no one felt her work was needed. And the other spirit guides were like, look, no, she wasn't doing anything. And as they tried to explain, the Supreme looked at them and said, you can't do anything without love and beauty. You cannot do anything without love and beauty. And interesting enough, they all are upset. They ask for her forgiveness. And she looks at them, and she doesn't forgive them at all. What she says is, don't let it happen again.
Don't let it happen again.
Don't let it happen again. And so she gets so, she's still sitting with the tension. And as she works out that tension, she turns in on herself. And she formulates and gives birth to who we know as one of the spirit guides of the crossroads, called Ilegba.
Ah.
And so that's where kind of this goes, because she had to make a choice if she wasn't going to reconcile she ended up reconstructing herself, mm-hmm. right? And reconstructing what beauty can look like in the world and choices can look like in the world and agency can look like in the world. And that is what she does in this odu. But I find it to be very significant odu when it comes down to understanding how we make our choices.
Yes. And I think what is a very important point about that is a lot of times in social justice work, we forget about beauty and love, right? Mm-hmm. It's all about doing the work. And,
yeah.
And then we judge people who aren't doing the work like we're doing the work, right?
That part.
And but you got to have beauty and love. And I like that beauty and love. Love isn't forgive. I like that. Beauty and love it doesn't forgive, but reconstructs what
yes.
your task is.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And I have a short poem I want to share that kind of, I think, talks about beauty and love, too.
Mm.
This poem was Good Bones by Maggie Smith. I'm sure many of you have heard of it. She wrote this in 2016, and shortly after I read it for the very first time is when the Pulse shooting happened. And I thought, what a shit show is this we live in? You know what I'm saying? So this poem, Good Bones by Maggie Smith, I think also speaks to where we are as an organization, as the world, as a community. Life is short, though I keep this from my children. Life is short, and I've shortened mine in 1,000 delicious, ill-advised ways. 1,000 deliciously ill-advised ways I'll keep from my children. The world is at least 50% terrible, and that's a conservative estimate, though I keep this from my children. For every bird, there is a stone thrown at a bird. For every loved child, a child broken, bagged, sunk in a lake. Life is short, and the world is at least half terrible, and for every kind stranger, there is one who would break you, though I keep this from my children. Mm-hmm. I am trying to sell them the world. Any decent realtor mm-hmm. walking you through a real shithole chirps on about good bones. This place could be beautiful, right? You could make this place beautiful. And I feel like that's where we are in this world, right?
Yeah.
There's so much happening, so much corruption and pain and, you know, gun violence is just will not stop.
Yeah.
It's a shithole.
Well, I mean, that's...
But it's got good bones.
Right? And then it's like, what is the... Like, often good bones have often referred to, like, good foundation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, a good structured garment. Or
yes.
What so have you. It's got good bones. I can repair
yes.
it, right? All the cobblers are basically gone out of New York because nobody's replacing shoes, right? But if a shoe has good bones,
yeah.
has good structure.
I actually have a pair of Born boots that the soles have holes in them, and I'm trying to find a shoey place to get new soles on it because they got good bones.
Yeah.
And I can actually walk in New York City in them, which is a big, important thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, and I think, I mean, right, in this idea of, like, we often think about, like, how things are changing and how things like that, material, mm-hmm. right, quality, right? What are we measuring as quality? What are we measuring as good material? What are we measuring as good foundation?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an important topic when we think about, like, what is our future, you know, within our movement, not only within our movement, but the places that we show up.
Yes.
I mean, we just came from Denver.
Yeah.
And it was very powerful.
We were at the American Humanist Association conference.
Yeah. And a lot of people just really resonated with, like, oh, my gosh, this is what we are doing. Yes, this is what we're doing. We're you know, and it's very interesting. It had a very Adlerinian experience because everybody was like, is this like a talk show? But like, like, is this like it's congregational? And it was like this teeter of like, who, what do we do? How do we do it? And it's like, I love to think of like ethical culture offering this like constant metamorphosis that it is able to change with the time.
Yes. You know, the metamorphosis reminds me of the life cycle of a butterfly. And so it goes from this little larval grub to a caterpillar to the chrysalis to the butterfly. It's the exact same DNA.
Yeah.
And what I find most fascinating about that, and I think Adler did this for us,
mm-hmm.
Is that within the caterpillar, there are what's called imaginal cells. Mm-hmm. So there's the imaginal cell of wings and of antenna and of all the thing it not yet is, but it one day will be. And so when the caterpillar creates the chrysalis, it's not curled up in the chrysalis. It is the chrysalis. It becomes like this mush, this primordial mush inside the chrysalis. And then the butterfly cells, the imaginal cells, begin to arise. But what happens is that the caterpillar cells still think it's in charge and it sees it as an invasion. And when you see a chrysalis shaking, it's because the caterpillar cells are trying to fight back the arising imaginal butterfly cells. And it's like it's a stranger. Wow. And if you ever see a chrysalis that doesn't become a butterfly, it's because the caterpillar won. And you know, I bet its last thoughts were, I won. No, you didn't. You just killed yourself. But he didn't know because it was different. It was strange. Ooh. So it's only when the imaginal cells come up, and they do begin to multiply more and more and kind of kick back the caterpillar cells, that's when the butterfly is born. But it takes this change, this metamorphosis. It's hard. It's scary. And the caterpillar doesn't know what's happening. The caterpillar only knows that life, as it knew it, is over.
Yeah. That's, you know, that's so interesting. I love that. You actually, just as you kind of were unpacking this caterpillar, I was actually, if you ever want to see it, it's on YouTube, but it's called the carnivorous caterpillar.
Oh.
Now, this is very unique. This actually kind of reminded me of when we were at AHA, the American Humanist Association, because this particular caterpillar actually sets itself aside from a like ant farm. But what it does is it produces a sap on its back, which then causes the ant and attracts the ant to it. Now, then it swells up itself with a lot of air and then makes a call, disguises its call and cry like a queen. Ant. Now, it's giving off the sap, which is to create this aroma, which is also then the cry is to then after that bring. So the ant actually grabs the caterpillar and brings it into the nest.
Oh, wow.
It was deep. I was like, ooh,
honey,
that's deep. And you get in the nest and no one can tell until much, much later, because the ants are just moving around doing their thing, taking care of everything. And this caterpillar goes to eat the larva of the ants. So this eating starts to take place. It has to disguise itself or otherwise it will be killed.
Mm-hmm.
It is amongst its predators. But it's completely outnumbered. But it hides itself in this. It's a very interesting detail. And as it feasts for a year to feed itself and nourish itself, beyond all of the predatorial behavior, it does the very thing that you talk about. It goes into this callus form and it stays there until it is ready to come out. And the fact that we can be in spaces that feel very predatorial, the fact that we can feel like we're too small, we don't have enough, it is fascinating to be amongst and learn.
And doing work, doing
right?
Work.
And doing the work.
Doing the work in the midst of an unfriendly environment.
Until we figure out how we bloom. Like, yeah. I was like, this is just something deep. And I find it to be like the way that we also kind of came in. Like, no one has really talked about, you know, ethical culture in the way that it was being presented. No one had, and it was like, oh, y'all are still a part of the AHA? Yes, we are. You know, and it was very beautiful. And here it is, it's like NYSEC. You know, is taking that. I feel you, sweetheart. You know,
we welcome all commentary.
Right, I know.
100%. Like, you're fine.
Right. So NYSEC was kind of the lead on this just this past week. So that was just very powerful. I was just thinking about like how we were just in the midst of different conversations while the AHA is also going through changes.
Right, and so let's talk about the AEU that Liz was talking about, because you know here we are. Adler gave us some really good bones. Mm-hmm. 147 years ago.
Indeed.
Right? And, you know, the New York Society for Ethical Culture is like the mothership.
That's the...
Here's where it all began. And And but the AEU, once we had other societies springing up, the AEU was formed, yeah. And now it's going through some changes. But does it have the good bones?
Yeah, I think, you know, as Liz pointed out, some of those tough scenarios and very challenging scenarios, I think it's a good time for us to look at not only who we are, but what we become in this moment. And I find that, when we think about the sabbatical, anybody who has a professorship or who has done some kind of work where they have to go and do research, like, we're not sleeping on sabbaticals. Like, we're really having to, you know, the board will have to align and figure out where, you know, who do we need to talk to? What are our societies doing, right? Because the AAU has been missing that ear for quite some time, and now it's really time for a lot of those board leaders to really lean in, right? And so that's the research. That's the getting back. I always like to say it. You do the AAU has to do some me search, and then do the research, mm-hmm. and then do the we search. Right? I got to go find the we's, right? Yeah. And so y'all are my we. And I find that to be very important, you know, where then when we look at the other scenarios, you know, ideas of like merging and so on and so forth, we want things that align with our values,
right.
So that we can actually maintain relationship, expand, you know, and as even like when we think about whether it's the, you know, whether it's the Humanist Association or all these, we need to be in better networking conversation, mm-hmm. so that we not only pull out network, but we also are able to lift up our net worth.
Right.
Right? Because that is our work. Right. We have very particular, unique things that make us who we are as ethical culture.
Yep.
And that can't be lost, you know, which and so I think that's important. And I think lastly, you know, our last scenario is kind of, you know, it has been maintaining the status quo. Just keep it where we are and hopefully we'll get it. You know, but I think when we think about that status quo narrative, you know, it's like, do you want to maintain a status quo?
No.
I don't know. And I also like to think of myself as being able to, you know, shapeshift and move in the world. You know, it's really awesome to like, you know, make a cab driver excited who's like 23 when they hear like, they're like, hold on, you're like clergy? I'm like, yeah. And they're like, shit, you're badass. And I'm like, I like to think of it that way. You know, but it's a different dialogue. Now, you know, of course, I mean, he was really super excited in Denver when he met me. But, you know, like when we think about like, what's the status quo? You know, what's the status quo? Are we going to maintain what we have or do we shapeshift? You know,
the thing about ethical culture is that, you know, our good bones, if you will, are some of the favorite sayings that we like to say, which is deeds above creeds,
yeah, yeah.
Right? Elicit the best in others, and that's how you elicit the best in yourself. And diversity of creed, unanimity indeed, which means that we didn't really care what you believed, you cared that you took action to do good work.
Yeah.
And the inherent worth and dignity of every human. Those are the good bones.
I mean, but let's just be real too. I mean, like, so since I've been in the building, which I love, by the way, it's been really interesting to be kind of always having a kind of worldview of ethical culture to sit and then kind of be like, oh, the AU has sought to mimic the dream that started right here in NYSEC. And this structure, these good bones are the good voice of what the AAU has sought to try to uplift. And I was like, you got to get connected, you know, as I've been sharing with a few, like, you got to get connected to, right, the good bones, because you can't just leave the bones, mm-hmm. and be like, oh, well, let's create this thing. You've got to know where the source is. And like, me being the person that I am, I'm like, I'm seeing how the building moves. I see how it works. I see its position in this community. And what does who is the AAU without NYSEC, right? It's really, it has nothing to model after.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was just very fascinating to think now it's like a remodeling, you know, and that's where I think about like reconstruction, right? To be able to lean into new parts of itself, you know, and when we think about NYSEC and the parts of itself that it is trying to lean into, right? Even though it might be uncertain or maybe it might feel, you might get hesitant, the truth of the matter is leaning into something. It doesn't mean that you're not gonna have discomfort, but it is what you transform into in in that moment of discomfort to say, I'm going to be courageous, mm-hmm. right? And also, I'm going to, I do everything while I'm scared. Leave it to me to have the roller coaster experience. I like screaming and also.
Well, you know, the people say that if you're feeling discomfort or fear, that means you're at your growing edge. And mm-hmm. To do change, you have to be afraid, or it's not change, right? Yeah. Like if I say to myself, I want to change my couch cushions from blue to red, that's not change. That's just changing, like rearranging chairs on the Titanic, right?
Yeah.
But if you're feeling uncomfortable, if you're feeling a little fear, that means you are at your growing edge, and that's when you have to push through, and that's where we are, because for 147 years, better part of 147 years, the identity of ethical culture was white, cisgender, male, straight. Mm-hmm. That's who it was for.
Yeah.
And that's who Adler was. And that's who his audience was at the very beginning.
Yeah.
And, you know, Richard even was telling me that Adler, I hate the word leader. I hate that's just the most archaic term. But what Adler called himself was lecturer. Leader's better than lecturer any day of the week. But
nanu, nanu.
Yeah, right.
I'm your leader. Right.
So what do you think are some changes we want to see for the coming generation? How do we need to metamorphosize, as Liz said?
You know, as I've been listening to, I know everybody, you know, like most of the time when we think about like, you know, talk about youth or younger, like it's really fascinating to talk to, you know, students who are like 23, right? I'm 40. So like, I'm kind of like, King and Adler started doing major shit by 23.
Yeah.
Right. You know, and they were young, right?
Yeah.
They were young.
They were pressing the envelope of their day.
So like, I haven't even seen my day, right? I'm 40. I'm like,
I'm almost 61. I'm not sure I've seen mine.
I'm on hold. I'm still on the shelf. You know, but like when you think about like, you know, listening to these to our youth and how they are taking in information, it's so fast. But I think one of the things is like it is the technology. But I am fascinated to see how people evolve with language.
Mm-hmm.
And that's like keeping up and up with language is one of my biggest things. Like I find myself to be, you know, fortunate because I go in between two worlds. I hold this very vibrant, you know, population that is in their 20s, as well as I hold, like, let's be real, my mom and dad are baby boomers. So, like, I'm, like, having this very powerful conversation. And it's, like, when I hear people, like, you know, excuse my French, shit on baby boomers, I'm, like, no, like, actually, they're wisdom bearers. Like, they've held things down. And, like, you know, what does it look like when we step in, you know? And also, like, remember, right? And then shift that essence, mm-hmm. right? I would have never imagined doing what I'm doing right now. So I think, like, when I think about the change, that's even like, how did my community support me, right, in creating a new dialogue for myself? And I think this is one of the things about mothering, when we can bring this in. Just to, you know, I find that it's very important for organizations to change from the mothership complex,
mm-hmm.
thinking that they hold it down. And they've held it down for so many years. I think we have to move into a very organizational mothering versus mothership, right? This idea of establishment. I have this many years behind me. You should listen to what I say. And I think now a lot of organizations like our own are also just really seeing that's not working because we need a mothering organization, which means that we have to actually be the ones to really be the midwives, to really kind of help, you know, our youth, our people, when we hear a really good idea, help them expand on it. Nurture them with the values of ethical culture, right? Take those values and find connection. They don't have to sound the same. Lord knows, I don't ever hear anybody sound like, I'm like, but I'd love to lean in on somebody and be like, yeah, that's that. You know, I relate to those values. And I think that's you and I, like we didn't come from the same space at all. We are definitely two cloths. Right? I mean, if you are silk, then I must be polyester. Right?
Like, no, you're just fabulous.
like I'm just like, but if we hold it, right, if we hold it together, we realize that we can stitch something wonderful.
Right.
Right? And it's not going to be easy.
Right. And I think that, you know, the AEU, Ethical Culture New York Society, we're at this place of, as you say, the wisdom bearers who have really been responsible for captaining this ship and bringing it to where we are.
Yeah.
But now the ship that they wanted to steer, young people don't want to get on. So,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We gotta change it up. And we have to honor the sages in our midst and also figure out a way that we can bequeath ethical society to the younger generation, because it's not going to look the same.
Yeah. I've learned you cannot infantilize this generation younger than me.
No, you cannot.
Like, you cannot, because they are reading. They are knowing, like, and
they're saving the planet. They're saving the planet.
Part.
It is the young people who are saving our planet right now.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So how do we, how do we support that? What ways do we need to shift? What imaginal cells are fighting to come forth that we're beating back because it's different?
Yeah. Right? And I think it's been really interesting to also have Ethics Unplugged to be mm-hmm. like, we are actually having an opportunity to see, like, what is community turning into? Because it's not the same for what we would think of. It's not going to fit the status quo thing. It's going to actually look very different, and it's going to be us getting out, and sometimes mm-hmm. maybe us just dialoguing after. I mean, you hang out with most of the people that, you know, lingering after, mm-hmm. and they're just, and it's a very different vibe. The conversations are everywhere.
Yep.
Right?
And so, I don't know. Do you want to open it up for questions?
Yeah, I'm open. I mean, yeah, especially like Crossroads Future.
Yeah.
You know?
What metaphors do you think we need for humanism or for ethical society that will make space for the next generation?
Yeah.
I'm going to give you this one.
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay. If you don't mind my starting, when you're talking about the AEU, I really agree it would be a great idea to open it up to other humanist organizations and make it the American Ethical Humanist Society, because there are a lot of other organizations out there, and they're all small, and if we join forces, we might reach a lot more people.
Make me want to sing that song. Reunited and it feels so good.
So I actually have a question around change in terms of, like, theory. How do you feel about people who are like, well, change needs to come in slow and incremental versus we just need to kind of blow it up and go with the change and get used to it then?
I think that there's a place for both, frankly. But I do feel that what happens if you go slowly and incrementally too often is then that you don't actually ever change, because you're feeling all the discomfort. And then there's actually a friend of mine created this whole organizational work on change called the change cycle. And it's like this cycle, and about midway through, you're beginning to talk about implementing, maybe thinking about possibly within the next several months implementing change, and that's that point of fear, and then you go back to the beginning. It's like, not to put too fine a point on it, on Mother's Day, when you're giving birth, there's a point where you just gotta push.
Yeah.
And it does not feel good, and it's scary as hell, but that's the only way something's gonna get born. And so I think that, and for, you know, like for things for like Ethics Unplugged, it's very different. And I know that that's caused a lot of fear and resistance in some of the NYSEC members, because it's different. But the other thing that's important, and maybe this is where it's both, and Steve, is I like to think of us as a buffet. You're not going to want, the goal is not to eat every dish on the buffet or to even like every dish on the buffet. If you don't like shrimp cocktail, don't eat it. Go on to the roast beef. Somebody else will eat the shrimp cocktail, and they won't eat the roast beef. And then you got the whole vegan section over here. But So if we can think about NYSEC as this living organism that has many modalities, and some are going to be radically different from what we've known, then that's okay. But if we don't push into it, if we don't lean into the fear, if we don't break through that fear, we're always going to stay on the growing edge and never grow.
Yeah. I mean, I think the only thing I can think of, you know, in hearing your change, did you want both of us to answer? Okay, I just try, you know, I'm like, I'm gonna let Nori, you know, I think you speak to change in a way that brings folk in. I'm like a hurricane, so you know, it's already been blown down, and like, what are we building? But I think about change in a way, to a relationship. Change is really about, like, if you think you understood anybody. And most of us don't even know ourselves until we experience something as we've gotten older, right? As someone who's been partnered for 14 years, I cannot say I know everything about my partner. I just can't. Because there's always something changing. There's always something changing. I can make an assumption, but that takes away the agency to want to grow, to want to be like, that's not what I'm doing anymore. This is where I'm at in my life. And I think when I would love to hear our organization say, this is where I'm at in my life. And that, and the life that they deserve to have. Like, when I think about it, it's not about having the life that you deserve should be fulfilling to a place, not where you become complacent or comfortable, but you have gotten to a place where you're saying, I'm gonna take charge and seize this moment to really show up. And that's a lot of, and so when we think about relationships, if I may bring it in, I'll be honest, I think one of the fascinating things is most folk don't, you know, will stay in a relationship waiting for somebody to change, as if they're going to change because you said so, right? And we miss our opportunities. We miss our opportunities because we have not yet grown, you know, or we're still holding on to parts of ourselves or narratives about what has been told to us. And honestly, I think that's the thing. We are holding on to, sometimes we are holding on to, a little too tight to Adler. Sometimes we are holding on too tight to 19, you know, 30 or 40 or this leader from this time. And I find that it's like, we can hold to all those things. Those are great bones. But what are the values that transcend where we are?
I'm gonna say they're good bones, but there's no longer any meat on them to feed us. So we gotta create that. I see a hand over here, Amy.
Sue. Yeah, I just I agree with Amy. We should join forces. We should join forces with the other humanist society, and I think that's a good idea because everything is fragmented too much, and I agree that we have to stand up for values of truth. Very important, because the big lie is being pushed by the Republicans and other people. I hate to get political, but it's true. But anyway, we also have to stand up for saving the planet, which we've been doing. I mean, there's no problem. All the humanist societies agree with that. We have to stand up for renewable energy and push it faster as it goes along. And the humanist societies and young people have a lot to say. Young people have to, you know, come along with that. I'm sure young people are very much concerned about the future of global warming, and by joining together with these other fragmented humanist societies, we can maybe push it along. And but the value of truth is extremely important, and like the values of love, okay, and the values of truth, you know, and that you mentioned, and I just think we can push society to regenerate, like you were talking about. You want to regenerate the society so it attract more young people. But we have these values that are extremely important, and that should attract young people. You know, I was thinking about Nietzsche. Nietzsche talked about the why cannot find an answer. We live in an age where the why cannot find an answer, and therefore we're in an age of nihilism, and I'm giving a little speech here.
That's good. Thank you, Ken. Thank you very much. Wrap it up.
But I think we can overcome this by giving people meaning through developing their own well-being and developing happiness, and thank you.
Thank you so much, Ken. Second platform of the day. We appreciated that. You know, when I was thinking about going back to the change, to the slower, or, you know, push through change, was the whole, you know, frogs in boiling water concept, that if you put a frog in a cold pan of water, they'll sit there, and if you just gradually turn up the heat, gradually turn up the heat, it'll boil to death because it's so incremental. If you were to set it from cold to boiling, the frogs would hop out, but they get used to that, and they die. And so that's my fear, is that we're going to be in this place of stagnation that we're not going to get out of because it's so incremental.
I think one of the things, too, is just like I think we just have to hop into change. Yeah. I mean, I don't think we're, I hate to say it, but I'll tell you why I hate to say it. I hate to say it because it feels like a rush. I'm not concerned about an organization saving itself as much as I'm more so concerned about people really wanting to step in fully to ensure that they are creating the change, right? And like so the organization doesn't have to save itself. It's the people that do that work, right? And it's our changing our mentality, changing our thinking. We would have to right now because it's 2023. Like, it's a different kind of care and ethic within living in general. Like, who walks around your neighborhood looks different than probably who walked around your neighborhood 50 years ago. Heck, even just within the 80s, I mean, New York changes, right? It's just, so like, how do, you know, it's not the same people, right? And I think that that's key.
Hi, I just wanted to say I agree with everything that Ken said. I thought that you were very eloquent, Ken, and I appreciated it. But I'm gonna take a risk here.
Okay.
And I'm gonna say, you know, I'm gonna say I look forward to an organization with hundreds of members that's vibrant and filled with lots of things to talk about. But one of the big problems that we have in this society today is a problem with communication. And, you know, if you had members, you know, sitting around a table and you surveyed them, I think that 6 or 7 out of 10 would talk about the communication problems that we have. So I can't see with having more members how communication problems are gonna get any better. And so I guess I would just like to, communication's important. You know, making people feel like they belong and that they're answered and they're respected is critical to an organization. Like Ken was talking about the values. So I agree, you know, I fully support everything that you're trying to do. I appreciate your energy, but that's an issue that gets talked about frequently among the members, and I don't hear it being addressed.
So yeah, you went.
Sue, you're absolutely right, and that is, I've been a minister for this July, 34 years. That's the number one issue in every congregation, no matter what the belief system is. And I know it's something Liz cares so much about and, you know, is trying to, and just the other day, Liz and I were talking and she said how things, with all these things exploding, we've got to get better at communication and we've got to get better at really making sure members feel that we value them and that they belong. Hold on a second.
Sue, I'll give you back.
I just want to point out that I was having a problem a couple of years ago with something, and I just couldn't get it to move along. So I went to the executive director and said, I really need some help on this. His response was, I'll send an email. So I went to a leader, and the leader said, there's nothing I can do. So, you know, you have to have some way for when someone is reaching out for help that someone responds. I don't know who it is. I don't know if you have to hire a new person that is just there to get responses, but it's important.
I'm sorry you had that experience, Sue.
Caring committee?
Hi, I'm Tom. Before Liz was the New York representative on the AEU board, I was for 6 years. And I didn't come away with much, but when I was on the board, it seemed to me that the primary thing the AEU did was train leaders. And Jay, you went through the AEU leader training, didn't
you?
Yes, I did. Right?
Yeah, completely.
And Nori came from the Unitarians, but you're taking some training now. But to me, that was always the primary function of the AEU. It did other stuff, but the core of it was training leaders. I just wanted to make that point. Another thing that I learned when I was on the AEU board, in terms of your talk today, was that the societies that managed to grow typically grew by having a very strong youth program that attracted people because they wanted their kids to have a godless, ethical Sunday school.
Yeah.
And those parents then became the board members and kept the organization going. Mm-hmm. If you look around this society and identify people who came in through the Sunday school or through the youth program, you'll be amazed how many people came in that way.
Yeah.
Those are just my two points.
No, I appreciate that. I think one of the things that, you know, I often try to consider. Hold on, I need to take a step back. I need to say thank you for your honesty first. Okay? I need to acknowledge that. And I'm going to answer your question, my brother. One of the things is that I do believe that, too, with the demographic that we're seeing, especially in New York, you know, it has always been amazing to see, like, societies or our societies have really great youth programs, and then all of a sudden, you know, of course, parents bring, you know, so that they have that. And then there are, you know, technically, some of us, if not most, a great deal of numbers in New York do not have children.
In this society yet.
Yeah, and so, like, you know, to actually tap into what people do consider their kind of offspring, like my artistry is my offspring, right? I think that's just something that, like, I just really hold to, you know, as someone who, you know, I move in that way, right? I look for creative possibilities, right? I look for, and so, like, when I'm working with other folk or when I connect with other people, I find our space to be so flexible to offer vibrant, courageous, creative, endless possibilities. Especially, you know, within a community in a changing social definition, if you will. Like, when I say social definition, I'm talking about, like, it's not the nuclear family, right? I'm a polyamorous, like, all that thing. If I laid it all out, my world is colorful, and some
people have a very long descriptive title,
right? I don't even bother to put that in there, because it's just like, in order for our place that we are in right now to really, I think there is so much that it's just like, how do we find the intersections? And I think this is what me and Nori have been doing for the past, gosh, since 4 months. Yeah, just, you know, what are the intersections, and where do we meet? Where don't we, right? And using, you know, kind of using our experience as a model also informs the collective, and I'm really grateful, because, I mean, when we talk very clearly about, you know, how are we going to, you know, now feel like we have a small community that is actually interested in informing program possibilities that really do speak to the community that they also are experiencing, because it's not about us just creating it, it's about cultivating it, right? And asking people, like, what are you experiencing that we can bring into this community? So I'm excited to see that kind of, you know, see how the society has maintained, you know, well, the AU, how it will maintain its integrity while also growing, because people change. And what does that mean? So you don't have to lose your integrity, but people think that's what that means sometimes.
Right, and I think that if you were to look at the two most currently successful ethical societies, which is Washington and St. Louis, in terms of numbers, they have the most vibrant programming. They do have a good youth program, but they also have they have dynamic Sunday platforms that are a little different than ours.
St. Louis does a lot of things throughout the week.
And they do a lot of things throughout. We have a lot of, I think COVID was a really stifled us, particularly here in New York, where it hit so bad.
Yeah.
And people were moving out. But I really want to go back to what Ken said, because I agree that people come here not just because they want to hear a good talk on an important issue of the day, but where do I find value? Where are my values mirrored?
Yeah.
And, you know, people come here on Sunday morning with heartache and with pain and anxiety and about things happening in their lives. It's not just to hear a good lecture, but it's a place to be in community, a community that cares for you.
Asha.
And so I think that's an important thing to remember as well. We're running out of time here, so we're gonna carry on. Please stick around and talk afterwards, though. I'd love to hear from more of you. And so now we're gonna do the, every Sunday we donate to a partner organization that reflects our values. And today's partner, this month's partner, is a Planned Parenthood Action Fund. More than 100 years ago, Planned Parenthood was founded on this simple idea, your body is your own. If it is not, we cannot be truly free or equal. So the Planned Parenthood Action Fund works to advance access to sexual health care and defend reproductive rights. Our goal for the month is to raise $500 for this organization. Please help us reach this goal by, you can either from where you sit, scan that code, or go to our website and give there. And so I have a smattering of the buffet that is New York Society for Ethical Culture this week. Tomorrow is Pantry Day for the Social Service Board, and they need two volunteers to help out from 9:30 to 11 a.m., so if you can do that, meet Richard and company here. Also tomorrow, Norman Siegel will speak about the First Amendment and free speech here, right here in Ceremonial Hall and on Zoom. Tuesday at noon is the Lunch with the League of Women Voters. Guest speaker will be Dr. Cheryl Kunis, who will speak about the privatization of American healthcare. You can register via the League of Women Voters site, or I think on our website as well. It's $20 if you do it before, $25 at the door. Wednesday at Ethics Unplugged, right downstairs in the big house with me and Jay. Our theme this month is Wild and Holy Embodiment. And it's about really, in social justice activism, we focus so much on the head, we forget our body. And it's about ways we can find pleasure with our bodies.
Yeah.
If that sounds sexy, well, it kind of is.
It is.
It is.
But
really,
I mean, of
sexy.
Course, you can also talk about pleasure from the Buddhist standpoint.
Exactly.
And finding pleasure and happiness is always beautiful.
Exactly. Right? Beauty and love.
That just happens in
it's
meditation.
It's about bringing beauty and love into your life. It's
Look,
about
Hygge,
Hygge, if you're Danish. So that's Wednesday. Thursday's, of course, Leaders Roundtable at noon, Zoom and in upstairs on 514. And Friday, this Friday at 7 p.m., we're going to have a performance and talk back with our Echo Artist in Residence, Jody Sperling, and the Time Lapse Dance Ensemble. That's free. So I hope you come to some of those events. Finally, next Sunday, our platform with Dr. Joe Schumann will be an interview with former NYSEC board president Meg Chapman and Sister Catherine Patton, a trustee of Marymount Manhattan College. We're trying to bring five imperiled Afghan girls to safety here in New York. We're trying to get them here. And one of the things we'll be asking for is if you have a spare room where you could be like back in the day when your kids would do foreign exchange students, it'd be like that. If you have a space in your apartment or home to house one of these girls, that would be great. And you can find out more about all of those things, for including the suggested donations and RSVPs where necessary, to our website, ethical.nyc. And so now we're going to do our closing words, and then... Yeah, I said that.
You said 7 p.m.
Yeah. Yeah, 7 p.m. right here. Yeah, thank you so much. It's a very exciting talk, so we're super excited to have him. So we're going to end using a little bit of religious metaphor, but kind of in a transformative way.
We got one more song after this.
And then we're going to redo this closing poem, and then Jen Dog's going to give us one more song, and then we're going to close it up.
Awesome. Pray for Peace by Ellen Bass. Pray to whomever you kneel down to. Jesus nailed to his wooden and or plastic cross, his suffering face bent to kiss you. Buddha still under the bow tree in scorching heat. Adonai, Allah, raise your arms to Mary, that she may lay her palm on your brow. To Shekinah, Queen of Heaven and Earth, to Inanna in her stripped descent.
Then pray to the bus driver who takes you to work. On the bus, pray for everyone riding that bus, for everyone riding buses all over the world. Drop some silver and pray.
Waiting in the line for the movie, for the ATM, for your latte or croissant, offer your plea. Make your eating and drinking a supplication, making your slicing of carrots a holy act, each translucent layer of the onion a deeper prayer.
To hawk or wolf or the great whale, pray. Bow down to terriers and shepherds and Siamese cats, fields of artichokes and elegant strawberries.
Make the brushing of your hair a prayer. Every strand, its own voice, singing in the choir on your head. As you wash your face, the water slipping through your fingers, a prayer. Water softening things on earth, gentleness that wears away rocks.
Making love, of course, is already prayer. Skin and open mouths worshiping that skin, the fragile cases we are poured into. If you're hungry, pray. If you're tired, pray to Gandhi and Dorothy Day, Shakespeare, Sappho, Sojourner Truth.
When you walk to your car, to the mailbox, to the video store, let each step be a prayer that will all keep your legs, that we do not blow off anyone else's legs or crush their skulls. And if you are riding on a bicycle or a skateboard in a wheelchair, each revolution of the wheels a prayer. As the earth revolves, less harm, less harm, less harm.
And as you work, typing with a new manicure, a tiny palm tree painted on one pearlescent nail, or delivering soda, or drawing good blood into rubber-capped vials, twirling pizzas.
With each breath in, take in the faith of those who have believed when belief seemed foolish, who persevered. With each breath out, cherish.
Pull weeds for peace. Turn over in your sleep for peace. Feed the birds. Each shiny seed that spills onto the earth, another second of peace. Wash your dishes, call your mother, drink wine.
Shovel leaves or snow or trash from your sidewalk. Make a path, fold a photo of a dead child around your Visa card, scoop your holy water from the gutters, gnaw your crust. Mumble along like a crazy person, stumbling your prayer through the streets.
And I really want to point out that verse that Je read, with each breath in, take in the faith of those who have believed when belief seemed foolish. Because we're humanists, because we don't have a creed, because we don't believe in supernatural deities, doesn't mean we don't believe. We believe very deeply and dearly in the ability of our own tender flesh and blood and good bones to change the world. So let's change the world.